you very much. I would like to thank the committee for the invitation and the nice organization. I guess they kept the best for the last. I have to agree with Dr. Burak and Dr. Fahad regarding the healthy colon. We have to have exercise, stop smoking, and healthy diet. This is 100%. So what we're going to talk, I'm going to talk about more about the surgical aspect. I'm going to share a little bit with Dr. Fahad what he said. I think colon cancer is the third worldwide, now it's coming the second, and the disease is rising, especially in Kuwait. And as you know, that starts from the lining of the colon and the rectum, and usually start from non-cancerous polyps. So we know that the colon and the rectum, usually from the rectum, and the main function of the colon is to take the fluid, mostly the water. And as has been discussed, I think now in Kuwait, the first in Kuwait is colorectal cancer. And this is according to the KCC registry. And even though in Kuwaiti and non-Kuwaiti is the first, and the age group of 30 to 54, the colorectal cancer is still the first. So we have a problem. We have a problem that the colon cancer and colorectal cancer is really getting higher, and that we have high incidence in Kuwait especially. And in the 20 years, we have very high risk. So as we see from the picture, usually this is the distribution of the colon cancer. We see that sympathetic cancer a little bit, mostly in the rectum, and the left side and the right side. So what's the risk of cancer? I think it's been discussed with Dr. Fahad regarding this, but I'll go through them quickly. We have to know about polyp. Age is important. The older you get, the higher risk of cancer you're going to get. Of course, we have inflammatory bowel disease. And diet, I think saturated fat, I know there's a lot of study, controversial study, but I think there's also study showed that saturated fat increase the length of the stool in the colon and can lead to cancer. Personal family history, of course. Obesity, now a new study showed that obesity linked with the colorectal cancer and been published by obesity surgery and smoking, and there's other activity as well. Of course, colorectal cancer familial is being discussed. I'm not going to go through them. It's already been discussed, the FAP and HMPCC. So how the cancer developed? Development, of course, from environmental and genetic, and diet has, lifestyle is important, as stated, healthy diet, exercise, and smoking, and of course, there is 35% oral cancer attributable to diet, and 50 to 75% of colorectal cancer in the U.S. preventable by diet. So, what's the good thing about diet? If you eat healthy vegetable, fruit, and antioxidant, calcium, and folate, increase if you eat a lot of red meat, animals, saturated fat, refined carbohydrate, alcohol, and of course, smoking. What's the symptoms of colorectal cancer? So what they present usually with? So they usually present with mostly, some of them they are asymptomatic, or they can present with change bowel habit, and diarrhea, constipation, and feeling unwell. They can present with bright red blood in the rectum. They have a change in the stool caliber, where they have narrower in the stool, or difficulty going to the bathroom, of course discomfort and abdominal pain as well. So the symptoms can be early, mild, and late. You have none in the early, only occult blood, and late you have all the parameters: fatigue, anemia, abdominal pain, and weight loss and abdominal mass. So according to the site of the colon cancer, they can present this differently. In the right side, mostly they present with pain. In the left side, in the rectum, they present mostly in change in bowel habit. So this is a different type of the presentation regarding the colorectal cancer. So the early detection that we discussed earlier is important, and screening is crucial, and we can save life. So this is what we want to prevent. We'll prevent this polyps, which is can be cancer later on. So as been discussed, is the adenoma carcinoma sequence start with normal epithelium and then ABC mutation if you have familial syndrome or FOX2, and then goes to KRAS and B52 all the way to the colon cancer. So how the screening is important and how it saves lives. We have about 33 reduction in mortality by using only focal occult blood. If you go to flexible sigmoidoscopy all the way down, the mortality goes down by reduction by all the way to 90%, as been discussed. So what we have, as been discussed with Dr. Fahd, we have colonoscopy, virtual colonoscopy, or colonography, sigmoidoscopy, focal occult blood, double contrast enema, and digital rectal examination, which is, I think, is a crucial as a clinician, and we should do all about the digital rectal exam. So as we discussed at the American College of Gastroenterology, the screening age is 50, and for Black American is 45. For Kuwait, unfortunately, we don't have any yet, but this is the worldwide criteria we use. And colonoscopy every year, and then you go to FOP, as been discussed earlier. The American Cancer Society also recommending screening. They use the same FOP, flexible sigmoidoscopy, double contrast enemas, CT colonography, colonoscopy, or fecal DNA. So this is the FOB is being discussed. This is the, we use it as a stool, and I'm not going to skip it. This is a double contrast barium enema, and as we've been discussed in the book, this is the apical core appearance of the cancer and the double contrast enema. What's the pros and cons regarding the double contrast enema? It's examined the entire colon. The pro is relatively low cost, but the study is not can't be used as a screening tool by itself. It's missed the polyps in 50%, and detection rate is not so high. Colonoscopy. I think the colonoscopy is the main tool for screening, as been discussed, and has multiple positive things. It's inexpensive, reduce the mortality, as been discussed, and easier operation. But we have, of course, complication, which is perforation and bleeding, can detect half of the body. We need expertise. You need somebody who is experienced, like gastroenterologist, who is used to do colonoscopy and flexible sigmoidoscopy. It's the same thing. The CT colonography, and it's been discussed as well. It show you the polyp, and as been seen here, and the same thing is the cancer, and also another tool for screening, and it's been discussed already. How about capsule endoscopy? Capsule endoscopy is not used for screening tool, but it's used for diagnostic mostly. We have the BILCAM, and the patient take the tablet to their mouth and has it built, and we record all the movement from the mouth all the way to the anus until, and then will be read by gastroenterologist mostly, and give you if there is any polyps. This is the picture inside the webcam and the capsule, and this is actually the colonoscopy. So it actually is comparable to each other. Focal DNA testing has already been discussed and has been used for screening as well. Now staging, how about staging? Staging is crucial for colorectal cancer because staging is going to determine the prognosis and the treatment. So we should know about the staging. So so we have staging to see, describe the cancer and the depth of the tumor. We have the TNM, which is going to include the depth, the lymph node status, and distal metastasis. And the last thing is, as I said, is that the treatment depend in the stage. So stage zero, what's stage zero? Stage zero is going to be that in situ tumor, and it's going to be removed by vulvectomy, and this is curable. You don't need to do anything else. We just need follow up. So this is stage zero, and you have the tumors only in the abnormal cell in the mucosa, and nothing, the lymph node is normal, and there is nothing else here to be done. Stage one, and this is going all the way to the, going all the way to the muscularis, and it's just starting going, and the surgery is also curable, and going all the way, if you see it here, to the muscular mucosa, and the touch of the muscularis mucosa, and stage one usually also surgical, and they don't need any other medication after that. Stage two, now stage two is going all the way, it goes through to the beyond the muscularis of the colon, of the, or the rectum, but it does not spread to the lymph node. So stage two is now is being divided more, and the treatment of stage two is a little bit depend in the stage itself, is it stage A or B or C, and also it's surgical is the treatment, and it goes ahead. Some of them they give chemotherapy or radiation after, depending on the location of the cancer, the rectal or colon. So stage, we have stage 2A, stage 2B, and 2C. And this is the tumor, and this is the tumor going all the way to the pre-colonic fat and going all the way spread to the other organ. And this is the new classification of the staging. Stage 3 even subclassified even more, where we have a lymph node, and the treatment of this is mostly surgical chemotherapy for recurrent cancer, and for rectal cancer is going to be a new adjuvant and surgery and plus chemotherapy post-op. And the staging is a stage 3A we have. This is two variant. We have 1 to 3 lymph node and the tumor is just T2. Or T1 here and going all the way to 4 or 6 and then subdivided to stage 3B, which is 3 variant as well, and stage 3C. Stage 4 is the, when it goes all the way to the distant metastasis, to the liver or to the bone, and of course the treatment is chemotherapy, plus minus of course surgery, but still we have to do surgery, and also we can resect the metastasis. The metastatic colon cancer as well in the lung and the liver now, and because it's prevented, it's better for the prognosis and extend the life of the patient. So this is stage 4, colon cancer, and now this is the new TNM staging. It's been published just last year, of the colorectal cancer. You see they subdivided the teeth all the way to T's, T inside to T0, all the way to T4, A and B, and N is being subdivided as well, because they found that by subdivision there is a difference in the prognosis, and for which the treatment is going to be different, and the M as well, they subdivided to A, and this, the, all the new stages as well, from 0 to 4. The survival, because as what we said, the staging is very crucial for the survival. As what we see here in A, the survival is much better than D, and according to the stage, of course, the survival is better, and the treatment, of course, has been different. Duke staging is another staging system. It's been used in Europe and not in the States, and they divide in A, B, 1 and 2, and C, 1 and 2, and D. And of course, they, according to the mucosa, we're going to the muscular mucosa and then to the lymph node, plus minus, and then to this the metastasis and the prognosis according, or the survival according to the stage. And this is the survival, A, we have all the way up, and D, all the way down in 5 years. So the colorectal cancer is the surgical therapy is a curative, and likely to be, and the early detection is very important in colorectal cancer. So how cancer, colorectal cancer, be evaluated? So the evaluated first by examination and history is crucial. We go by doing digital rectal examination. Diagnosis confirmed by a biopsy is a colonoscopy to confirm the diagnosis. And then go ahead with a CT scan, MRI according to the stage, to an endorectal ultrasound is very important, plus the MRI for rectal cancer. So colon cancer, let's go colon cancer and what the management we can do surgically for colon cancer. So colon cancer, so how will this be assessed? If you have somebody or a patient who has colon cancer, how is going to be preoperatively assessed? So we're going to do clinical exams, we'll do FA, we'll do a blood test, including CBC, liver function, coagulation profile, and cross-matching. We need to do renal function, SEA, carcinoembryonic antigen, and microsatellite instability for the biopsy in selected cases. We need to do chest x-ray, we need to do CT scan of the chest, abdomen, pelvis, and of course colonoscopy has been done to diagnose the cancer. If not been done, that's to do other modality. PET CT scan is not a routine to be done preoperatively, but we can do it if we think that the patient has metastasis. So this is the CT scan, show the tumor here, it's as a preoperative, and you can see the tumor is thickened in the colon, and it's a modality to diagnose the cancer preoperatively. In the day before surgery, we give them a clear liquid diet, usually preoperative preparation. Now there's a new study that showed there's no need for bowel preparation, no need for oral antibiotics. The only need is IV antibiotics preoperatively, but most of the surgeons, they prefer to give them bowel prep, especially if they are doing laparoscopic resection. So the difference between laparoscopic and open is all the scar, and laparoscopic is a keyhole surgery. This is the only keys you have, and this is the old scar. So what resection we have? We have multiple resections. We're going to discuss them separately, and each according each alone. So this is the most important for the resection, the anatomy. I know that you'd be tired now at the end of the day, but the anatomy is crucial for the resection. We worried about the right colic for the right colon. We worried about the middle colic for the right and the transverse. And the left IMA is crucial for the left and all the way down to the rectum. So this is the thing you keep in mind for the resection, which is very crucial. So for the right hemicolectomy, we resect the right colon all the way to the small bowel with the tumor and resecting the ileocolic and plus minus the right colic. And in the extended right, where we have the tumor and the hepatic flexure, we have to go all the way to the middle colic. So without resecting the middle colic, you will not do an oncological resection. So this is the extended right hemicolectomy. Transverse colectomy is not done routinely because we worried about the watershed area, but it's been done. You have to transect it with the middle colic. And left hemicolectomy, you resect the left colon all the way to splenic flexure. And extended left, you go all the way to the middle colic and you leave the right, or you go subtotal. Sigmoid colectomy, you go to the sigmoid colon with the IMA, you remove the IMA and you do colorectal anastomosis. And the total colectomy, you remove all the colon all the way down and you anastomose the small bowel all the way to the rectum according to the tumor size, or if the patient has FAP or has other reason. Sometimes you need to resect the rectum or the colon, and we call it that to do total proctocolectomy with ileal pouch and anastomosis according to the, if you have the patient FAP or HMPCC. So how about colonic obstruction? What's different between the colonic obstruction and normal colon? What the surgery is going to be different? Different is the patient is going to be sick in this patient. So it's obstructed, dehydrated, and usually they presented with symptoms of constipation, obstipation, abdominal distension, plus nausea and vomiting, and abdominal pain. So this is the key about bowel obstruction. And the important thing is resuscitation, as I said, is dehydrated. So you have to resuscitate the patient, put good IV lines, give him good fluid, monitor his output, NG tube, Foley, and you need to do the blood test, including the CT and blood investigation, and then you have to decide about the operating room. And it's going to be done soon rather than later, especially if the patient has virgin abdomen and you think about cancer. So this is the picture of the X-ray of colonic obstruction. You can see everything is distended, the small bowel and the colon as well. Here is the barium enema of colonic obstruction. We don't recommend to do a barium enema for somebody who's obstructed, but it's been done, and you can see that the barium is not going in this, in the left side of the colon. And CT is crucial for somebody who's obstructed mass in the colon, and can show you this, the cancer and how bad is the distension and how bad the cecum in these patients. What to do in the colonic obstruction, what type of surgery we do? We can do a Hartmann procedure where we can resect where is the colon, and we can give him a stoma and we'll give a distal stump. The other option we can do is the total colectomy and ileorectal anastomosis. Or the third option we can do, total colectomy and ileostomy, with a reconnection, without reconnection. So it depends how the situation is. How about rectal cancer? Rectal cancer, what shall we do with rectal cancer as a surgical management? So rectal cancer, the preoperative assessment is more or less the same as colon cancer. The extra thing we do in rectal cancer is the endorectal ultrasound, because for preoperative staging, and of course to plan the treatment, because if the rectal cancer has a stage of T2 and above, he might need a new adjuvant chemo radiation before we go ahead for surgical therapy. So this is the ultrasound we usually do for a transanal or transrectal ultrasound. And you can see the tumor here in the side, showed in the ultrasound, and also can show you the lymph node, if you have a lymph node in the ultrasound. In the MRI, it can give you the circumferential margin, which is very important, as we were going to see, because this is for total mesorectal excision, and we can see the tumor here as well. So what the surgical option for rectal cancer? We have the LAR, low anterior resection. We're going to resect the lower part of the rectum and reconnect the descending colon all the way to the upper part of the rectum and to the anus. And we have abdominal perineal resection, which will resect all the tumor, if it's the tumor involving the anus or close to the anus, where we can't preserve the muscle for continence. And we'll give him permanent colostomy in this case. This is what we like to prevent most of the time, if we can preserve the anus, and there is other, by new adjuvant chemo radiation, we can help the patient in these cases. This is what I said about the TME, the total mesorectal excision. We need, as being studied thoroughly, and by doing total mesorectal excision, we know that we decrease the rate of recurrence and better prognosis. So we have to take all the rectum and all the surrounding mesentery all the way up to the dentate line, and taking all the tumor with the lymph node as well. This is the total mesorectal excision. And this is all been done by now laparoscopically, and this is the specimen usually have. This is the lower rectum, this is the upper rectum, and this is the pedicle, and this is what you see when you remove all the rectum with the mesentery and the lymph node. What's new about the local excision? We can excise the rectal tumor locally, or we can use the transanal endoscopic microsurgery, which is a new regarding, it's not a new virtually, but in Kuwait, unfortunately, we don't have it, where we put a small instrument through the anus, and we can put multiple instruments through, where we can resect the tumor up to 10 centimeters from the anal verge, which is a give you advantage where we don't have to do all other procedure abdominally, and to prevent stoma. And this is very helpful for T1 tumor. T1 tumor is very helpful, or in situ. I have a small video to show you how we can do the low anterior section. Laparoscopically. Okay. So what we start here, we start with inspection of the abdomen. We inspect the liver first to see if there's anything in the liver, and inspecting the abdomen. Now we'll go to the pelvis. You can see these dots. I don't know if you appreciate it. This is actually tattooing. This is our gastro colleague. We do it with them, where we tattoo the tumor. But this, the dot is outside already. It went through the colon. Now we're taking the adhesions slowly. We're taking the adhesions on the left side. And now we're going all the way to the IMA. We dissect medial to lateral approach. We identify the IMA, where we can ligate the IMA. This is the ureter. This is where we protect the ureter and dissect it. We use the LigaSure device, which is a device used to coagulate the vessel up to 7 millimeter. Now, this is the IMA. The IMA, either you can take it with the device or use it with a clip. We can put a clip in it, and then the device can take it as well. Some of them, they can do it without even a clip, because this is a very powerful device. We dissect the colon all the way up to the spleen by taking all the side wall. Here we're taking the side wall between the colon and the side wall. And here we're taking the lift. as you know, they call it line of Toles. We take the colon from the line of Toles all the way to the spleen, this is the kidney here, and goes all the way to the spleen. We're mobilizing the left colon. So we can do a tension-free anastomosis between the resected part of the colon, this is the spleen here, and going all the way where the main thing with the aim, the main aim doing this to prevent anastomotic leak. So by doing this, so this is the left side now again, this is the ureter should be here. Now we'll go in the pelvis. Now we're dissecting the left distal rectum, and this is the tumor. The tumor is here. So we're going to dissect the left side of the colon, going all the way down to this, the pelvis, taking the left side and the left lateral, and using the ligature. The ligature device is very powerful. They can coagulate up to 7 millimeter, 8 millimeter vessels. Now we're going to go posteriorly. This is the rectum at the top. This is a small bowel, and this is we're going to the what we call the total mesorectum. We are not going to do total mesorectum in this case, but when you do it, you have to go all the way down here. This is the mesorectum, it's been dissected. And this is the side wall and the other side, taking the using the scissors, we use sharp dissection, where we dissect the colon and the side wall. And this is continuation of the mesentery, taking the mesentery at the back of the rectum. This is the tumor here, the tumor. You see the color is different a little bit because this is from tattooing. This is the tumor here, and the blue color is the tattooing. This will give us an idea where we transect the colon below. So this is the whole idea about tattooing. You see the color here is different. So this is the left lateral side. We dissected it slowly. And preserving the ureter here, usually the ureter here and the nerves and the lateral stalk. So usually we'd like to preserve, this is anteriorly and this is the bladder. The bladder is here and we'll transect the colon now all the way down. You see it's been dissected. This is the mesentery posteriorly as well. And now we thin the mesentery at the back by because we need it to be thin because to put the stapler. So the stapler to transect the lower part of the rectum for and with the tumor itself. So this is the stapler device is coming out on the side. We'll go all the way down to the rectum, where it's below the marking we put, below the marking, and with transection. You see the transecting of the colon done completely. Now when we transect the colon, we deliver the specimen to the abdomen using a small incision to deliver the tumor, and after delivering the tumor, we transect the bowel, and this is length lecture more, and this is the tumor here, the tumor has been completely mobilized and transected, and this is the pelvis, and this washing the pelvis for before the anastomosis, and to do the anastomosis, finally, we do an EEA device, we call it end-to-end anastomosis, it's going all the way through the anus, and the device give you the spike, now it will come, and the spike comes now, where we can do the anastomosis, end-to-end anastomosis. This is a device you use it through to make the anastomosis safely and easier, and this is the other end of the colon is being hooked together, and now we close together and do the anastomosis. So this is what we call it laparoscopic rectal resection, low anterior resection. Mostly is the resecting most of the rectum usually, but in this case it's been mostly the upper part as well. So this is the end result, and usually the patient eats in the next day. And thus I'm done. Thank you very much.